and statistics and say, here's how probabilities work. There's a lot of work currently in the machine learning community about how to interpret machine learning models, because as machine learning models start influencing our lives more, it's becoming more and more important to do that. In particular, if you have a robot that makes a medical diagnosis, you kind of want to understand why it made that medical diagnosis, so you can understand whether what it's done is actually correct, beyond just calculating some kind of accuracy. But let's go to a more astronomy example. Who of you knows what logistic regression is? Oh, good. I was wondering, there wasn't that much on just like supervised machine learning. But anyway, logistic regression is basically a way to write down a linear model. And when I say linear model, this is important. When I say linear model, I don't mean you fit a line through something. When I say linear model, I mean a model that's linear in its parameters. So, I guess, I mean a polynomial is a linear model too. Right, you have sort of three parameters W, and you have sort of different variations on X, and you can make that as big as you want to. But the point is, it's all sort of linear in these parameters. That's not the same as if you had, for example, AX to the power of B. That's not linear in its parameters because B is a parameter and it's an exponent. Anyway, so logistic regression is a way to do classification, a pretty straightforward way to do classification. And in the end, I guess in this case, it really did draw a straight line. You have some variable stars and you have some non-variable stars, and you drew a line through it. And sure, the question is now what? What do you do with that? And so my first question to you is, did any of you come with ideas for machine learning projects that you want to do, or is this more something you just want to learn for the future? Okay, most are sort of like not looking at me, thinking, I was like, oh, was I supposed to have a project? No, you were not. That was not the question. But the question that I basically want to ask you, based on what you know up to now, what does interpretability mean to you? And if you want to, you can like maybe have a 5-minute discussion with each other. What do you think it means to interpret a classification, for example, or one of the models that David showed you earlier?
They don't understand what's happening at all, but you will get right into it. So interpretability means that you can understand what's happening by looking at the did you design it with a specific observational application in mind?
Well, so I don't know, but the idea was to do one
application.
There are some other
Things.
we have this, notion that there exists,
And that also is for just as
I think the point is for the
So I guess, if you tell somebody, they try to be able to manage to do this thing.
Which part of it, so which part of it were you
involved? Shown to this kind of word life in a very and so I was first trying to use it. So then I thought this about it, but that was helpful.
Okay. All right.
So
who wants to shout in some things? Yeah, just go ahead.
I guess if you have a model that you claim is able to make good predictions,
okay.
Then if someone asks you why they should believe your model, if there's some way you can actually interpret the model coefficients or
okay.
parameters in a way that makes physical sense.
Okay, so is trust a good way to put this, like trust in the model?
I guess trust and then also some kind of physical understanding of what's going on.
Okay. What else? There was a lot of discussion.
It should be simple enough that you can convey it in a short enough time.
Okay. Simple.
It should be repeatable.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. That's actually quite a good list. I think there's a lot of people who do deep learning who would disagree with the simple opinion. At least in terms of making things interpretable, but we can talk about this later. I should also say, because this is such an active field of research, I sort of found a bunch of resources and sort of things that I think are maybe most relevant to you as scientists, but you should take all of this with a grain of salt that, you know, there's a lot of active debate about this out there, so. I think a lot of stuff about interpretability goes back to basically the two main goals of what you might do with any sort of model, be it machine learning or not. And that's kind of inference versus prediction. And I think you heard a lot about this morning. And in the sort of most general term, I think prediction is actually most useful. Machine learning is most useful if you have a kind of prediction problem. And if as someone said, you want to have a physical understanding, statistics is really what you want to do. They are not entirely separate. There's a lot of overlap between them. So there's a whole class of machine learning models that use concepts, especially for Bayesian statistics, which sort of allow you to sort of cross that divide in various ways. Just to repeat, but I think you already know that now. Inference is basically a conclusion reached on the basis of evidence and reasoning, which is about as broad as you can make that statement. But basically the idea is you have some data and you have some model for that data. And in order to inference, you try to learn something about that model by looking at your data. And one typical inference question you might ask is, why do stars have different colors than galaxies? You might want to be doing a classification problem, as you will do later in the exercise, where you want to separate out stars from galaxies. But presumably, the answer to that question is it has something to do with the initial mass function of your galaxy, so the spectrum is different, and therefore you get different colors. But that kind of reasoning, that's inference. You've asked why. You haven't just said just separate them out, but you've asked why they have different colors. Whereas prediction basically says, given you have some data point X and some outcomes Y, what outcome do you get if you put in a new data point X? And just here in this example, you have sort of two data points, and then in the shaded version, there's sort of the region where possible data points can lie. And that's actually here a good example of a crossover between machine learning and statistics, because that is actually, these gray lines basically outline a kind of probability distribution for where your points could lead. And if you cut through any of these, you would get a nice little Gaussian distribution. But these things are called Gaussian processes, and they are used in other fields as well, but there's been a big push in machine learning that's been using them a lot. Okay, so I need to give credit where credit is due. A lot of the stuff that I'm going to talk about comes from this paper, which talks about model interpretability. And in particular, the author has tried to sort of summarize why people want to interpret models and what the sort of properties of an interpreter model are. So one of the basic problems with machine learning is that maybe your scientific goal is to uncover a causal relationship, do an inference problem. But in machine learning, most of the time what you're doing is you're minimizing some kind of prediction error. So basically what the thing that you looked at yesterday in this exercise, where I think you used k-means, you probably calculated some kind of accuracy score or something. And the idea of maximizing your accuracy, how many samples you got right, is to minimize the error when predicting new samples. But these two are not the same thing. And so if you want to do causal inference, but all your process is geared towards that goal, you might end up with a big mismatch and misinterpret. So here's just a graphical version of that. You have some kind of input data. Then here you have a nice black box of your machine learning algorithm. You don't really know how it works. You don't know what the parameters mean. But you have some kind of evaluation metric for new samples. And that tells you it's a good model because I predict 99% of my examples correctly. But in practice, you might have a doctor who says, well, your outcomes actually determine what kind of treatment I'm going to give my patient, so I would like to interpret this as well. So, and that's kind of which of these, whether you focus on one or whether you're sort of interested in both of them, is something you have to decide. And I guess that's one of the things I would like you to take away from it's useful to think about what your goals are in doing machine learning, because that kind of will determine what kind of models you pick and how you go through the machine learning procedure. And there is, in many cases, there is a trade-off between sort of just focusing on getting as high an accuracy as possible or as low a prediction error as possible and making it interpretable, especially for difficult data sets. So why do people want to make models interpretable? Why can't we just throw everything at as complicated an algorithm as possible and just get our outputs? one big thing that was already mentioned is trust, right? In the case of, for example, the doctor, you need to kind of trust in that the model does the right thing. If you sit down in a self-driving car that drives with like 100 miles per hour down the highway, you kind of have to trust that it doesn't just go off the road. So being able to interpret a model helps with gaining trust in that model. But one of the big questions, of course, is what do you want to trust in? What does that mean? Is it okay if you sort of know the parameters or understand the parameters? Do you need to understand like the entire model? Being able to understand a model is a way to gain trust in the model because you can reason about why the model makes certain decisions. But for many of the complicated models, that's actually hard to do. Another sort of metric of trust could be a low test error. If you know you say, well, the car does not go off the road in sort of 99.9 out of 100 cases, that's good enough for me. And you say, well, the accuracy is high and the test error is low, it'll be fine. The other thing you have to think about is whether your training data matches your deployment environment. And that's, for example, a few years ago, I was at a conference and I talked to people who were doing sort of high energy, one of them was doing this high energy particle experiment, sort of with cosmic ray experiment. And they said for years they'd been using these heuristics to sort of like simple rules to say that's a cosmic ray, that's not. And for their experiment, they decided to move to machine learning and they found it was terrible and it didn't work and all of machine learning was bad and nobody should ever use machine learning, and they went back to their heuristics. And then I talked to them for a while and I realized that they were training on simulations. And because their simulations didn't perfectly match the incoming data, the machine learning algorithm didn't generalize to their actual data because their simulations didn't match up. And so that's an important question to ask. That's especially an important question to ask if the results of your machine learning model can influence sort of what the machine learning model does in the future. So your environment might just be non-stationary and change with time. So here's the sort of, this is kind of, here, this is basically just a bunch of LSST simulations with, this is with W first for redshifts. And again, the question is, if you now train some kind of machine learning model to derive redshifts from photometric measurements, and you train that on your simulations, the question is how good will that work on the real data? And so there is this question there of how do you inspire trust in a model? The second thing that I already mentioned was causality. If you want to find causal structure, that's a form of having to interpret your machine learning model. That's just like which was there first, the egg or the chicken. But so causality is a big motive for trying to understand machine learning models, especially in science, where most of the things that we're interested in is actually the physical knowledge about some kind of system. The other one that's maybe not completely obvious is transferability. And that's kind of related to what I said about trust earlier, that about how sort of your machine learning model generalizes to new data. And so the example that I've seen several times is actually for medicine, where these people at Microsoft train a machine learning model on data about pneumonia, which is like lung disease. And they found that people with asthma had a much smaller probability of dying if they also got pneumonia. So if you just trust that machine learning model, you would say, well, if someone has asthma and pneumonia, you don't need to treat them as much, and they'll be fine because they have a much lower probability of dying. And that was all the information the model had. But in fact, when they then asked the doctor said, patients with asthma have actually a much higher probability of complications, therefore they're rushed to the intensive care right away and get a much more aggressive treatment. But the machine learning model didn't know that. And so you have to be really careful about what kind of reasoning you make about your model based on whatever training data you have, because there could be factors that you just haven't seen, that you just, that are just not part of your models, but are actually important for your inference. And so in this particular case, if the doctors had blindly trusted the model would have not worked, because the patients they would have admitted with asthma and said they now get a much less aggressive treatment, they would have suddenly developed many more complications, because that's what asthma patients with pneumonia do. In the sort of context, the astronomy context I could think about that doesn't exist yet is, again, kind of LSST. And so this is the community infrastructure for transient alerts, which looks really complicated. And I don't pretend to understand all of it, but LSST is going to produce a lot of alerts per night. And so one question that you can ask is, you know, how do you train your model? In particular, how do you train it to sort of say some alerts are interesting and some alerts are not interesting? And once you do that and others respond to that, how do you incorporate that information into your model? How do you make your model sort of transferable as maybe your environment and your feedback changes? The last one is informativeness. Basically, one thing that might be interesting, I think maybe less in astronomy than other fields, is given that you see an example, how well can I sort of reason about other examples? So say you see a galaxy, and then you take a galaxy that's maybe close in some kind of feature space from your machine learning model. How much can you reason about what is happening in terms of physics in those galaxies? So again, informativeness is this kind of is one of the motives why people want to interpret machine learning models. So how do we make an interpretable? How do we make a model interpretable? And there's sort of several levels to this. The first one is basically transparency. And instead of having some data and a black box and then your results, you say, I don't want a black box. And so the sort of highest level of transparency is what's called simulatability, which is a terrible word, but it's basically the ability to understand the model in your head. And this works if you have, for example, if you have a really simple model and a few parameters, you can sort of in your head say, if I wiggle this parameter, this is what happens to my output. If I wiggle this parameter, this is what happens to my output. For example, who of you has heard of decision trees? Oh, good. So, well, basically, you have a decision tree which has sort of three different features, age, student, or credit rating. And then, based on that, you decide whether someone has a good should get a credit or not. And so, you can basically reason your way through this, right? You can just put this all in your head and go, okay, here's what's happening, depending on certain. But that's not what usually your decision trees looks like. They more look like this. And you have this sort of giant structure up here, and that's even not the full one up there. This is just like a small part of it. And so this is a sort of huge tree, and suddenly you can't reason your way through that anymore. You can't just say, you know, if I shuffle this parameter, what happens to my prediction at the very bottom of the tree? And so simulatability usually works for small models. There's a kind of less strict version of this, which is decomposability, which basically means you can't understand the entire model, but you can understand bits of it. Maybe you can understand how the parameters work, or maybe you can understand sort of how certain parts of the model behave. And so that kind of local understanding of the model can be very useful in some cases without having to sort of keep the whole model in your head. And there is, in fact, I've seen a couple of libraries that help you reason about local models, where they say, we're just going to take this part of the model, and then we're wiggling around parameters. And then the output that you get from that kind of code is basically an analysis of how your outputs change if you just wiggle bits in that local bit of space. The last one that's sort of not entirely related to that is just algorithmic transparency. You might not be able to reason about sort of individual parameters, but you might be able to reason on an algorithmic level about how certain things work. You might be able to prove that an algorithm converges, for example. As a side note, humans have no algorithmic transparency whatsoever. If you make a decision in your head, nobody can tell like by which algorithm you've actually made this decision. You can reason about it afterwards, but there's sort of no algorithmic transparency in humans. So this is the part of transparency, or this is basically how transparency helps you interpret models, because just by keeping things in your head. You can also think about post hoc interpretability. Given that you've run your algorithm, how can you get information out of it? In the sort of image classification world, what people often do is they classify an image, and they also train a natural language processing classifier, and they sort of give you a natural language description of what it classified in the image and why. And so that's a kind of post hoc way to interpret what your model's done. Visualization is, of course, a great tool to do some kind of post hoc interpretation of what your algorithm has done. And then there's also learning by example. You can always basically look in your feature space, and you look at the sort of, say, if you want to know something about the parameters, you can look at the parameters one example, and then you look at examples that are close in feature space and see how they compare to each other in the classification. There are other ways you can kind of think about what to do in terms of making your model more interpretable. One simple thing is you can train, well, I said a linear model, but basically an interpretable model. And you can also train a black box model, and then you can just compare the two. And one thing you might find is that maybe your interpreter model does really badly, and your black box model does really well. And at the very least, you can say that your simple model, there's structure in the data that your simple model can't capture. It gives you a quantification of how much your simple and your complicated model, how much your simple model can capture, and how much sort of non-linearity you need in your problem. The other thing you can do is train so-called surrogate models. You can train a black box model to do really well, and then you can try to train an interpretable model on the predictions that this has done, and then try to interpret that. I've never actually tried this, but it's sort of one of the things you can do, and try to sort of reason your way by seeing how well your simple model does on that. You can also just train an ensemble of simple models. If your simple model, one of the simple models, can't do very well compared to a black box model, you can train several of them and hope that several of these interpretable models will sort of capture different types of structure in your data. And so taking them together, your one model will capture this part of structure, and your other model could capture this part of structure. And taking that together, you can start interpreting what is done. Okay, in the interest of time, I'm gonna skip that. But basically, conclusion of this whole discussion is think carefully about your goals. What are you trying to achieve when you're doing using your machine learning model? Think carefully about your features. One thing I haven't actually mentioned that I should have mentioned is that these simple models, like the one I wrote down, they're interpretable as long as your features are interpretable. So you could have a simple, let's say you have actually a simple linear regression model. So you're just fitting AX plus B to a line. You're just fitting some kind of line. That's of course really easy to interpret. You just have AX plus B and it just makes a line in a two-dimensional space. But what if X is not, say, the luminosity of your star? What if it's some kind of other thing that you computed based on some dimensionality reduction technique or something more complicated? And then suddenly your AX plus B, your X is no longer the simple sort of, can no longer draw a simple linear relationship between physical variables, but you have something that you transformed in some way that's much harder to interpret. So interpretability kind of also depends on your features and then your feature engineering. How much you change your features compared to the meaningful sort of physical quantities that you measure. Cool. Are there any questions up to this point? Or is everyone just thoroughly confused? Okay. Should I just, I'll just go on with the second part? Or do you have a question?
I will ask a quick question / interjection. So later this week, we're going to learn about some models that you can build where you don't actually have to do feature engineering. The algorithm itself actually sorts out what the features are. This is what you've maybe heard referred to a few times as deep learning. When working in that area, though, interpretability, as we've talked about, it's kind of gone because you can't look at features. You can't know what's going in. For many other problems, feature engineering is it's everything. You can have a great data set, but if you can't put the data in a format that your machine's happy with, you won't be able to get a good result out of your model. And we'll play around with that a bit more on Friday.
Yeah. So one of the points that this is the part I skipped. Maybe I should have skipped it. But this was basically That was basically the question that I had to you, and then I realized that you don't know either logistic regression or deep neural network, so it's maybe not a fair question to ask. But basically, the question is, what is easier to interpret? This kind of like model, that is sort of very, very straightforward and simple compared to this kind of like network of where you have maybe not three parameters, but 1,000 parameters. And so the answer kind of is it depends. As I said, if you need to highly engineer your features and you have very high dimensional variables, even your sort of simple model may no longer be very interpretable. However, linear models kind of do have a better track record of modeling the natural world and identifying weaknesses in the training data. So in terms of inference, I think mostly simpler models are probably a better idea. Maybe the deep neural network people will disagree with me on that. But that's what I think anyway. There is one other thing, so high dimensional variables, one of the things you're gonna do in your exercise, I think, unless it's one of the challenge problems, is you're going to play around with this kind of logistic regression model. And one thing that you'll find out is that in some cases, they're actually very sensitive to what what features you use and what features you don't use. So if you just like, sometimes these coefficients, these like model parameters can change very much just because you left out a feature. And so if you're trying to derive causal structures from these parameters, that can be very difficult because they're so sensitive. Okay. All right. Very quickly-ish, model selection. Basically, the point of model selection is two things. One, if you just want to make predictions, you want to avoid overfitting, because I think you probably heard about this on Monday, you can make your model as complicated as you want, but the question is, will that model still generalize on new data points? Because it's very sort of goes up and down, and if your next point is kind of here, as it could be if it were sort of, if that were the right model, then you might get a really bad fit to that. So avoiding overfitting is a good reason why you want to do model selection, why you want to think about the kind of parameters that your model has. In terms of inference, usually you do model selection to decide between physical models. So in terms of inference, maybe the number of clusters that you're trying to derive is actually has some kind of physical relevance, because you're trying to decide whether there's a certain type of source in your data set of that particular galaxy or not, and whether you have that type of source makes a difference to the physics that you're deriving. So usually you're trying to derive between different physical models. What do I mean when I say models that you want to select between? You can just decide you want to select between algorithms. You can say what works better, a logistic regression model, a random forest, or a deep neural network. That's a model selection problem. Most algorithms have specific parameters, like, for example, in clustering, the number of clusters. Some of the linear models also have regularization parameters, sort of how much you penalize for adding more parameters, essentially. And you might also want to do feature selection. So you might want to decide on which features are important and which features aren't important. And then think about that. And the sort of top ways in which people do model selection in machine learning is something you've already heard about, and that's cross-validation. And there's roughly four different types of cross-validation in the literature that I could find. We're going to go through all of them. There's like holdout cross-validation, k-fold cross-validation, leave-one-out cross-validation, random subset cross-validation. And we're going to go through them, but before I do that, I want to do a bit of nomenclature, because that is not standardized in the machine learning literature. And just so you know how I'm going to use these terms, is of the data of which you have ground truth labels, sort of things that are already classified that you don't now want to use to train your algorithm, you're going to generally split that into three in some way. You're going to have a training set, which is just the data set that you train your algorithm on. And then you have a validation set, and that is the data set you use for comparing the performance of different models. So you can try out different parameters, and you use the validation set to figure out the performance of those different parameters. So then you can then pick the one with the best performance. And then usually you also have a test set, and that test set you split out at the very beginning, and you don't do anything with it until your paper is basically written, and then you use that only to compute the error of the final model that you've chosen. Yeah?
How is the test set and the validation set different? Because it seems like if the test set is different than the validation set, that you can have, for example, a smaller error with the model that did not perform on the validation set but performed better on the test set.
That can happen, yes. But the...
So, sorry, may I?
Yeah, go ahead.
So, part of the idea, so the
talked about this yesterday, but you don't want to snoop, right? So that's the idea of essentially looking at the data that you're going to ultimately sort of describe as your generalization here. So that's the test data, that's the test set, and that's why that always sits apart, aside. You don't, in principle, you don't ever look at that until you're, until you've decided, now my model is as good as it can possibly be, how well does it apply to general, to general data. In many cases, and what you're doing in cross-validation is the training set and the validation set are actually the same in that scenario, because you're validating on a subset of the training set which you're holding out when you train. And so I think that's part of the reason why the terminology can be confused here.
Yeah.
And then if you look in the literature, you'll find some people that actually create three independent sets, training, validation, and test. But again, at the end of the day, the most important thing is that you have a test set that you don't snoop.
Yeah.
Right? So the test set has to sit aside, you don't look at it, you don't measure performance on it until you've done as good as you can possibly do with your model.
From a statistics point of view, basically your validation set is like a statistical set that you run over and over and over, because you use your validation set to compute your performance for different parameters and different models. And so basically from a statistical point of view, if you do many statistical tests, sometimes you end up with a favorable result just by chance. And so the test set helps you guard against that kind of problem. I should mention that these two are sometimes switched in the literature just for maximal confusion. So just be wary when you read this, especially also, I think this even happens on some of the figures I'm going to show. Okay, so basically holdout and k-fold cross-validation are...
Can I make one more comment?
Yeah.
So that one other thing to remember too is that there is noise in these algorithms. So you know, you can run cross-validation, you can run it again and get a very different answer depending on exactly what your data structure looks like and whatever's happening under the hood in the black box. So one way to combat that you'll find in the literature often is that people will run the same model several times and then report the range on the results that you get. So especially in a case where if you have a relatively small training set, right, you might expect that the noise will be larger for cross-validation.
So, I have a question about that. So how then do you decide how many times to run something? I mean, I'm guessing it depends on your data and the algorithm itself, but what variations are you looking for?
I would say for my own work, that's generally influenced by how long I have to wait, which is maybe not the best answer or the most rigorous answer, but you know, if you have a huge model and it takes 3 weeks to run, I don't think you should run it 100 times and now your PhD is over and you don't have a paper yet. That's sort of the practical consideration. There are probably heuristic arguments you can make about stopping criterion for
I mean, one thing that I would look at usually in terms of, for example, for the k-fold cross-validation where you do it several times, I sometimes look at the variance in the scores that I get. So for example, if I did this machine learning project where I had very imbalanced data sets. So there were many examples of one class and just a few examples of the other class. And in k-fold cross-validation, now I can just explain this, what you do is you say split your data into, say, 10 parts. And then the first time you run your algorithm, you keep out the first part and you train on the other 9. And then the 10th part is your validation, and that's the validation accuracy report. The second time around you run it, you take out this bit from your training data set and train on everything else, and then validate on this one, and so on, until you've done this 10 times, and then you've got 10 validation accuracy scores. And so for my problem, if I'd split it into 10, I would have gotten a huge variance in my validation scores, just from the fact that I had these weird imbalanced classes, and also in the beginning that I haven't actually shuffled my data properly, which can be a problem. And so there is, you know, you can use this kind of variance to distinguish, or at least give you a first idea of how you're doing. Were you going to say something?
I was just going to comment that the stopping criteria, yes, meaning that would be the logical thing, and going for some error or some precision value. And then you can also keep a watch in the sense that many times what could happen, if it's not improving, then it flattens out and it's never going to reach that. So you may also want to see that how much change is happening in successive iterations.
Okay, cool. So I just explained k-fold cross-validation. Holdout cross-validation is basically k-fold cross-validation where k equals 1. So you just have like one bit that you keep aside as a validation set. And that can sometimes be useful because if you're, for example, comparing different algorithms, it's not that easy to run cross-validation across different algorithms. OK. Here's another somewhat more complex version of this. But what I want to see you to see is that here on top, you've got this like test set that you never touch until the very end. And you have the validation set that you use to sort of compute errors for different models. And you pick the one with the smallest validation error, and then that is what you use at your final model. So this could be, for example, say linear or logistic regression and a random forest and a neural network and a deep neural network, and then you try to compare them in this way. Leave one out, cross-validation is a special case of k-fold cross-validation where k equals n. So in every time you have a validation set of one data point, you train on everything but that one data point, and then you predict on that one data point. And that's particularly useful if your data set is really small. That can work better than k-fold cross-validation. But it's very computationally expensive, so there's this kind of trade-off. There's also, if I have time, I want to say something about that. There is a direct relationship between leave-one-out cross-validation and information criteria, which is something that people use, especially on unsupervised models to sort of test performance. And then lastly, random subset cross-validation. Instead of sort of taking a chunk out of your data, you pick random samples. And that can be a good idea if your data is sort of ordered in some way, but you want to sort of make sure you pick from everywhere. It's probably not a good idea if you have time-dependent models, where sort of your current value depends on previous times, because if you take that out, you're sort of losing that continuity. But that can be a useful approach as well. As a small aside, one thing that I want to discuss is, what do you actually compare doing cross-validation? Right? I said you train your algorithm and then you compute some kind of score on the validation set, and then you compare these scores. But what's that score that you're comparing? I think so far, you've only worked with accuracy, and accuracy basically just tells you the sum of all the samples that you predicted correctly as a fraction of all the samples that you have in your data set. And that's really useful, but it's not always the best thing to use. Okay, as an example, let's take LSST alerts. You have the predictions, you have 10 million alerts per night. I just said maybe 0.1% of them are interesting. It's probably still too many, but let's just assume for the sake of argument that 0.1% of them are interesting. You train a machine learning model to find the interesting ones out of your 10 million. You're doing your model selection, your cross-validation, and you get an accuracy of 99.9%, and you think, awesome, I can now find all of the interesting sort of LIGO events in my LSST data. There's a problem with that. And that's an empty slide. And that's the so-called accuracy paradox. If you have an accuracy of 99.9%, but for the model it was actually really useful of just putting all your interesting alerts into the uninteresting category. Because when it puts all, like, because you have such an imbalanced set of classes, it's actually preferable for the algorithm to put all your, it can be preferable for your algorithm to put all the interesting cases in the uninteresting category, because you get a really high accuracy. So that's a problem. There is a whole bunch of different metrics for different use cases. For this particular problem, for my imbalanced classes, I used something called the weighted F1 score, and that basically computes a score on every single category separately and then weights them by the sort of total occurrence of that data set. And so that pulls out much more, because then it says each class has equal weight in the final number. Misclassifying your small class actually makes that score really low. So depending on what you're trying to do, sometimes you actually want the other thing. You want the accuracy to be really high and you don't care about your small classes. But there are sort of specific cases where maybe you care about, the few examples of the interesting LSST triggers, and you want to be sure that they don't get classified as don't follow up, because otherwise you might miss the Nobel Prize. So, okay. In terms of unsupervised classification, that will be really quick because Matthew mentioned something like this morning. You can sort of do an unsupervised classification, say, by doing some sort of clustering, or maybe with, this is, I think, a Gaussian mixture model, which you're going to learn about more tomorrow, I think. And one of the big problems, of course, is in terms of computing a score, you can't just compute an accuracy score, because you said I have variable and non-variable stars. The computer made clusters, and it said my clusters are called 0 and 1. And so one of the sort of, problems is you have to sort of figure out which is which you don't know a priori. And there's a whole bunch of different metrics that I won't go through, except maybe some of the information criteria that you can use for various different purposes. And they all kind of have their advantages and disadvantages. Okay, I want to talk a few minutes about feature selection, which is the sort of last item on my list of model selection, reasons why you do model selection. And so one reason why you might want to do model feature selection is you might have very many features, but not all of them might be very predictive, and you might not know that in advance. You might have, taken 50 different measurements of whatever you're interested in, and these but maybe only 5 of them are actually predictive. And it turns out for certain models, like this logistic regression model, having lots of non-predictive features can actually make your performance worse. And this is an example from a paper I wrote, where basically you ended up with some kind of validation score that sort of leveled off and then actually went down again. That got worse. So maybe only a subset of available features is predictive, so you might want to figure out which ones those are. And the obvious thing that you can do is just an exhaustive search. Like you can try out every feature combination with every other feature combination, sort of all possible combinations, and then do your cross-validation on that, find the score, try it out for the next combination, and then pick the one that has the highest validation score. But that's more than 2 to the n model evaluation, where n is your number of features, and that's quite a lot. So you probably don't want to do that. For linear models, there's this thing called L1 regularization, which is a specific way of basically penalizing against overfitting. And that type of regularization in particular tries to make coefficients 0 as much as possible. And so at the end, if you have a model with 50 features, but only five of them have non-zero parameters, you might say, well, everything else I can just throw out because it didn't really add anything to my classification. And that's something you can do in scikit-learn pretty easily as well. You can do a sort of forward search, and I have not found a good figure for that, but that's basically the algorithm. All this does is it says, take a single feature, compute your validation score, take the next feature, compute your validation score and that single feature, and then you do that for all your features. You pick the one with the highest score, and then you keep that, as that is now a feature that I'm using, and then you add a second feature, and again you go through all combinations of the feature that you're keeping with all other features, and then you keep the best combination of the two, and you continue that either until you have no more feature left, or you can define again some kind of stopping criterion. You can also do this backwards by starting with all features and then successively taking one out, but that sort of, that makes, it's still very expensive if you have many features, but it's a bit better about this. There's also filter feature selection, where basically what you're saying is you just do this once. You say you compute some kind of score on each feature alone, and then you pick the k features that have the highest scores, defined by some sort of cutoff. And that's basically this, where you said you have a whole bunch of, a whole set of features. For each feature, you define some kind of evaluation function, for example, the correlation between features and labels. And then you pick the k features that have the highest correlation between features and labels, and then that's your. And that only needs n evaluations, where n is the total number of features, so it's much faster. Adam, I can either stop here or talk about information criteria.
I would appreciate it if you spoke briefly about
okay.
So can I make a quick comment
yeah.
on this?
Mm-hmm.
So for this one caution, that it depends on what it is that you're trying to separate. If you don't know that beforehand, then you do not have a good evaluation function, and then what you do is going to be subject to that. So if, for instance, you're trying to separate stars and galaxies versus quasars from within stars, then your evaluation function is going to be different. So you may find that different features become more important.
Okay. Very, very briefly, the Bayesian perspective on all that. And I'm going to recommend a paper to you that you can read, which is, I thought it was quite readable and good, which is a useful, which was a useful Bayesian perspective on sort of cross-validation, stuff like that. The Bayesian perspective is basically you start with some kind of generative model and a likelihood and also priors, which I forgot to write down here. But essentially, David talked about earlier about how Bayesian statistics works. And so the advantage of that in terms of interpretability is that you have this kind of probability distribution over parameters. And these parameters you can usually directly connect to whatever physics you're trying to infer. So it's usually easier to interpret and reason about, but it's also usually really computationally expensive. So what people do is they will try to find approximations to sort of Bayesian model selection, where you basically compute the posterior for different models and then compare the posterior for different models. And these are often called information criteria, and there are sort of two different views, two different perspectives of information criteria. One is information criteria can be used as an approximation of a Bayes vector, which is sort of the Bayes vector is the Bayesian way to compare model selections because it's the probability of your data given some specific model. It is also, some information criteria are actually also an approximation of cross-validation in the Bayesian sense. So you can start connecting cross-validation, what I said about cross-validation, to sort of Bayesian statistics. And I'm not going to go through all the maths for that. But yes, you can read that up. So as in terms of an approximation of the base factor, here's Bayes' rule again. And in particular, of interest to model comparison is this part down here. And actually, all of these should have not just p of theta given y, but it should be p of theta given y, comma m, where m is some kind of model you assume. And that model could be a Gaussian mixture model with three components, or a Gaussian mixture model with four components, or it could be a Gaussian process or something completely different that gives you posterior. And so this term down here, which physicists call evidence, statisticians mostly call it marginal likelihood, is basically a probability of y, your data, given that model. And what you basically do in Bayesian model comparison is you take p of y given model 1 and p of y given model 2, and each of them you give a prior, and then you can make the ratio of them to sort of get an idea of which model is better. Like that. You get sort of a probability of your model given your data, and this is just what's down here. And if you have model 1 and 2, you can sort of make the ratio of this, and then this drops out, and you can make the ratio to sort of do this. The problem with this is that computing this involves an integral that's usually not tractable to compute. And part of why we do things like MCMC and related procedures is to find an approximation to that integral. But usually that's still hugely expensive, so you want to find approximations to this. And one of them is called the Bayesian information criterion. And that is a really rough approximation of the base factor if your priors are just unit and uniform. And that depends only on your sort of maximum likelihood estimate. So you take your likelihood and you optimize it and find the optimal parameters, as you often do in model fitting anyway. And that's this likelihood. And then it penalizes it both by the number of data points and then the number of parameters. And that turns out often to be a bit of a conservative estimate, and that can be quite useful just as a baseline. I'm usually reluctant to like make any hard inference statements based on this, but it can be, for example, quite useful in the sort of unsupervised learning context when you're interested in what's the sort of optimal number of clusters to use. I think statisticians would still advocate that you at some point just throw a big computer at it and do the base factor properly, but this can give you a useful first baseline. In terms of approximating sort of cross-validation in a Bayesian sense, there's a whole number of them which I've listed here, and they're all kind of approximations to Lieb-Wonnab cross-validation. I've sort of given you a graphical introduction to Lieb-Wonnab cross-validation, but you can go from Bayes' rule and sort of work out the maths through, and you end up with basically a Bayesian version of Lieb-Wonnab cross-validation. But which again is expensive to compute in many cases, so you can use these to learn something about that. In terms of Gell-Mann, who's a famous Bayesian who wrote that paper with co-authors, I think he mostly advocates this one, which both these two you could kind of derive from MCMC simulations quite straightforwardly. And so if you're interested in this kind of stuff, feel free to look at that paper. I'm just gonna mention two of them. The first two, this, I still don't really know how to pronounce that name, but Akaki, something, AIC, is a sort of less strict version of the BIC. It does not, as you can see, it has the sort of maximum likelihood term again. It does not have the sort of term that depends on the number of data points. And again, you can use this to basically find something like the optimal number of clusters in a context and where you have a generative model, but it's less conservative than the BIC, and it's only really this approximation if you have a linear model with flat priors, or you have a normally distributed posterior, which you oftentimes just don't have unless your number of data points goes to infinity in practice. And then this deviance information criterion, oops, oh no, that's right. It's basically a slightly more Bayesian version of the AIC. And so what you do is you, instead of using the maximum likelihood estimate, you take the posterior instead and make the mean of it, and then you use that as this term, and you replace this other term with a sort of bias correction that's based on the data. You don't really have to understand this equation, but sort of that's a bit of a more accurate version that gives you a better estimate of your models, and that's been used a lot in the literature. I've seen that also used in cosmology. That's basically all the information that I have. I've put down some resources, and again, you're going to get this, these slides, so you can look them up. Is there anything important on there? This is a really nice reference book for Bayesian statistics, but if you've never heard Bayesian statistics before, don't start with it. This Bishop Pattern Recognition Machine Learning is the book that I learned machine learning from mainly, and it has a lot of sort of the formulation from the statistics perspective. One of the great things is the PDF of this book is free online, so you can just download it. Okay.
All right, let's thank Daniela. And before we dive into the associated exercises, are there any questions? All right, well, I'm sure there'll be questions once we start the AI that notebook. So we're gonna work on the notebooks now. You should have done a pull request. And